All right, so I'm glad you guys are here because this is a really important lecture because we're going to talk about substitution. And in particular, we're going to talk about the SN2 reaction. So we talked last time. It's a pretty straightforward reaction if you look at the overall transformation, but it's actually a lot more complicated than it looks. So we have substitution. We have two mechanisms for substitution. We have SN1 and SN2, and these guys are in competition with each other, which means that you're going to be presented with reagents, reactants. You're going to have to figure out which mechanism is operating. Is it the SN1 or the SN2? And then when you come back from the break, then you're going to be talking about elimination. Elimination actually has also two mechanisms, E1 and E2. So there's four possible reactions, and you're going to have to figure out all of that when we come back. So this chapter is much easier. Chapter 8, like I said, when you come back from the break, is one of the most difficult chapters the whole entire year. So everyone's going to be reviewing a couple days before. You just go through and review your notes for chapter 7. That will help you out a lot. All right, so what I'm going to do, I follow a different order than the book. What I do is I talk about SN2, everything you ever wanted to know about SN2. And then I go and I talk about SN1, everything you ever wanted to know about SN1. And then at the end of the chapter, we compare the two so we can see what we have going on. All right, so I'm going to start with SN2. All right, so let's review the reaction type. This is a substitution. We know we have this polarized carbon iodine bond. The halogen pulls electron density away from the carbon, which polarizes the bond. So partial negative charge on the iodine, partial positive charge on the carbon. And of course, this is our electrophile. Our nucleophile here is ethoxide, and that's what we're going to be using for this particular example. So this is our nucleophile. Ethoxide ion. Or you can just say ethoxide. Our product is an ether for this particular example. And as we mentioned last time, this is a leaving group. Iodide's a leaving group. All right, so we want to know what's going on in this reaction. What type of mechanism do we have in this reaction? So one of the things that we could do is do kinetics. And we take the reaction and we vary the concentration of the reagents and we see the effect that it has on the rate. And that can give us clues about what type of reaction we have. So if you measure the kinetics for this reaction, and how we would do that is we double the concentration of the methyl iodide. Double this, rate doubles. If we double the ethoxide ion, the rate also doubles. And if you double both, just to double check, the rate quadruples. So that means that methyl iodide and ethoxide ion appear in the rate equation. Each has the exponent of 1. In order to get an exponent of 2, we'd have to double this and the rate would quadruple. We don't have anything like that. So this is a second order reaction because we add together the exponents for the two factors here. And so the rate is proportional to the concentration of methyl iodide times ethoxide. So rate is reaction is second order. The reaction is bimolecular. So methyl iodide and ethoxide, and we'll just abbreviate that ETO minus, must collide in the rate determining step. And I almost always abbreviate rate determining step as RDS, just to save myself time. So we call this reaction an SN2 reaction, substitution nucleophilic bimolecular. So that's what SN2 stands for. The following mechanism is consistent with the rate law. So this is our working mechanism here. And very often you have a working mechanism and then you try it out and see if it, you try to come up with experiments that will prove whether that mechanism is taking place or not. Okay, so here's a mechanism that's consistent. Ethoxide methyl iodide colliding in the rate determining step. We have the ethoxide attack the carbon and we kick off iodide. So the transition state would look like this, where we're starting to form a bond between the oxygen and the carbon, and at the same time, we're breaking the bond between the carbon and the iodine. And so we would have, if you look here, we would have a partial negative on the oxygen and partial negative on the iodine. So let's write our leaving group as iodide ion. So that has a negative charge, so that means that we need to have a partial negative charge in the transition state. So although the rate law indicates what atoms are present in the transition state, it provides no information about how they are arranged. So for example, I had the ethoxide coming in from the opposite side of the leaving group. We have a name for this, it's called backside displacement. So this is what I had drawn for our working mechanism. So again, that's backside displacement. Alternatively, the ethoxide ion could come in from the same side. And we're going to have to do some experiments to find out which way this is happening. This would be front side displacement. Well, we're going to talk about that. So what are you thinking? Why are you thinking it would come in from the backside?
Because there's the negative iodine there, so it's kind
of... Yeah, so he's predicting that it should come in from the backside, and I was just going to ask you. See, he reads my mind. He's close enough that he can read my mind. You guys can't. In the back, you're too far away to read my mind. So, what, you know, if we look at this, I think that looks better. Like he said, we've got these lone pairs. And we've got these lone pairs, and as they get close to each other, they're going to have electron-electron repulsion, right? So it might not want to come in from the front side here. So that's what I would be thinking too, just seeing lone pairs here, those guys are going to get too close to each other, so it might be better for this to come in from the opposite side. But we really do have to consider both attacks. So let's do that. We're going to run some experiments to determine which way this is actually coming in. So what we do is we do some chiral alkyl halides. So we have a chiral alkyl halide here, and then we look at where the arrangement of those groups. Do we get inversion of configuration, retention of configuration? That will give us a lot of information about which way the nucleophile is coming in. So if it comes in on front side, it would look like this. This is the transition state here if it comes in front side. And the nucleophile in the product would be on the same side as the leaving group. So I often abbreviate nucleophile just NUC with a lone pair. Nucleophile on same side as the leaving group. If it's backside attack, you can see we get the opposite. The nucleophile comes in from the backside. We already drew this transition state. It will look like this. And here the nucleophile is on the opposite side of leaving group. And we also might have a situation where we have both kinds of attack taking place. Okay, so we have to consider that also. So if we start with a chiral alkyl halide and we get racemization, it starts off R, we come R and S, then maybe both things are happening. Okay? So what are the experimental results? So we're using a chiral alkyl halide. We start off with S configuration, optically pure, 100% optical purity. That means we have none of the enantiomer. We have 100% EE for this particular starting alkyl halide. And we find that when we react it here, we get inversion of configuration. So the only way we can get, so notice that the HS is on the opposite side. So it comes in 180 degrees here. We kick off the bromide ion. And if we look at our product here, we have 100% inversion of configuration. If our nucleophile came in on the same side, that would be this scenario right here at the very top. If it came in on the same side, our nucleophile would be right there. It would be retention of configuration, right? So it doesn't look like our prediction was right. It doesn't look like this is coming in from the same side. And it's certainly not a mixture of the two. We just have, it looks like exclusively from this one experiment, we have backside attack. If we did another example here, so this particular example here, this ring is drawn so it's sort of perpendicular to your page, maybe floating above your page. And if we use azide ion, we get the same thing. So this is going to come in opposite the leaving group. So this is just an alternative way to draw these rings. You can also draw them flat, and then you would have the atoms on dashes and wedges. But sometimes I like to draw it this way because it's really easy to see the inversion here. So leaving group is on the top. Now this this N3 is on the bottom. So you can it can really easily see the inversion of configuration there. So 100% inversion of configuration. So definitely our experiments with chiral alkyl halides support the backside attack. So possibility number two. So we see that on the next page, SN2 reaction proceeds with inversion of configuration, always. So the SN2 reaction proceeds with inversion of configuration. So it's very much like an umbrella that inverts. If you've ever had an umbrella on a very windy day and the umbrella flips over the other side. So the nucleophile comes in as if it's entering underneath the umbrella. Backside attack kicks off X. X is our leaving group, and then the groups end up moving over. So it's like this, here's your umbrella, and it comes in like this, and then it flips over like that. Okay? So our leaving group's over on this side, so here's your umbrella, you come in, and then these groups move over like that. It's exactly how it happens. So backside attack results in inversion of the carbon atoms, the tetrahedron, like the inversion of an umbrella caught in the wind. It's exactly like that. Why is backside attack favored? We already talked about that. If we have frontside attack, we have severe van der Waals repulsion between the nucleophile and the leaving group. severe van der Waals repulsion between the lone pairs on the nucleophile and the leaving group. And of course, I'm just using LG for leaving group here. All right, so this is what the energy diagram looks like. And if you go back and you look at chapter 6, this was the AB plus C reaction. Okay, we're exactly duplicating the AB plus C reaction from chapter 6. So we, question? Excuse me?
What is BT?
BT, between. All right, so we have reactants. We're going to just label everything here, products. One-step reaction. Here's our energy of activation. Here's our delta H naught reaction. As you can see, this particular example is an exothermic reaction. Here's our transition state. We have the bond between the nucleophile and carbon forming simultaneously as the bond between carbon and X is breaking. We won't put charges on this one because we don't really have our nucleophile maybe. Let's do that. Let's put a little charge on our nucleophile to match what we have here. This one has a charge here. So that would mean we have partial negative and partial negative here. So as you can see in the SN2 reaction, no intermediates. It is exothermic. And it is one step concerted. Questions on SN2 reactions so far? Anybody? All right. Factors that affect the rate of the SN2 reaction. What do we already know? We know that the rate is proportional to the concentration of the alkyl halide and the nucleophile. We know what the transition state looks like. Partial negative, partial negative. And the rate depends on concentration of alkyl halide and nucleophile. And if we're going to be making decisions about whether an SN2 or an SN1 reaction takes place, we're going to need more information than what I've given you so far. So we know the bond of the nucleophile forms while the bond of the leaving group breaks. The transition state involves 5 groups around carbon. So take note of that. We've got 5 groups around carbon. It's getting pretty crowded in there, isn't it? Okay. So we're going to predict that the rate will depend on the factors that are important. Number 1, how strong of a nucleophile we have. If we have a weak nucleophile, it probably has a really large energy of activation for that nucleophile to attack the alkyl halide. Another factor, how well the leaving group leaves. So LG for leaving group leaves. So if we have a really strong bond between the carbon and the leaving group, maybe the nucleophile will come in and attack, but maybe the leaving group says, I'm not leaving, and that nucleophile just comes right back off again. OK? Okay, so we have to have a good leaving group. And then because of the fact that we have five groups around carbon, you might suspect that bulky alkyl halides or nucleophiles may cause a problem. Because the transition state is so crowded. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at all of these things. We're going to look at the strength of the nucleophile and how that affects the rate of reaction. We're going to look at the what makes a good leaving group. We're going to look at what happens when we have bulky alkyl halides or nucleophiles, what happens to the reaction. All right, so it turns out that these are all the factors that affect SN2, the structure of the substrate. So the substrate meaning the alkyl halide. What we're transforming it from one thing into another. So substrate, structure of the substrate, the concentration and reactivity of the nucleophile. If the rate depends on the concentration of the nucleophile, then maybe if we make it more concentrated, it's going to be faster. That makes sense. I mean, that's part of the rate law. The effect of the solvent, not obvious, but it's actually really important. That's not obvious from what we've talked about so far. And then the nature of the leaving group. These guys right here, B and C, go together. So it turns out that the strength of the nucleophile and the solvent together, those work in unison, and so we need to look at both of those factors. All right, so we're going to go through these in this particular order here. We're going to start with the structure of the substrate, and then we're going to move on to talk about nucleophile strength. So what we're doing in each of these areas here, so when we look at the structure of the substrate, we're going to change one variable, which is this alkyl halide, keep everything else the same, the temperature the same, the nucleophile the same, the solvent the same. All right? So we're going to do a good experiment. You change too many variables, you don't know what's the thing that made the difference, right? So we're going to be changing. And then when we talk about nucleophile strength, we'll keep everything else the same and change the nucleophile. So we're changing the alkyl bromide. We're going to use alkyl bromide here, keeping everything else the same. All right, so we start off with a methyl bromide. The relative rate is 1,200. So that of all of these, if you kind of glance quickly down, you'll see this is going to be the fastest, which goes along with our prediction that less bulk is going to make a faster reaction. So when we move to primary, so this one's primary, rate drops, but it's still 40. When we move to a propyl group here, that's still primary, but it slows it down a little bit. So and we, if we do here, secondary, that has a relative rate of 1. So when you do relative rates, you choose 1 as being 1. And for this particular experiment, these researchers chose isopropyl as 1 and did everything relative to that. When you do a tertiary alkyl halide, it's negligible rate of reaction. Primary hindered, 0.6. So I don't know the difference between negligible and 0.6. I honestly don't. It is negligible, 0.0006. That information was not given. And then we have primary hindered. So this is secondary hindered. And this is primary hindered. Then we get 0.0003. And again, what is the difference between 0.0003 and negligible? There is no number for negligible, so I would call that also negligible, right? So when it turns out that there's a factor that's really important here, and what we do is we label the carbon that's attached to the bromine as alpha, and then the next carbon over is beta. And so we have alpha and beta here. alpha and beta, alpha and beta. I'm just going doing a straight line here. So alpha is the carbon that's attached directly to the bromine, and beta is the second carbon over. And it turns out, it turns out that this has a beta, we call this beta a beta branch. This has one beta branch. So this has one beta branch. Slows down the reaction a little bit, right? It goes from 40 to 16. So it's still primary, but it's from 40 to 16. This actually is a secondary because it has an alpha branch. So that actually changes it from a primary to secondary. This one here has two branches in the alpha position, so that changes it to a tertiary. Here's secondary, but has, notice we have two beta branches. So when we have two beta, when we have one beta branch, it's 16. When we go to two beta branches, it drops down to 0.6. This one has three beta branches. Drops down to 0.0003. So beta branching slows the SN2 reaction down in a big way. Also, moving from primary to secondary to tertiary, that's alpha branching, affects it even more. Questions on this chart, anybody? Yeah?
For the two hindered, what is the hindered?
Right here?
Any of the hindered ones. So like the second.
Well, we're going to look at that right here. Again, you're reading, you're just like once, woo, reading my mind. This guy right here, he knows exactly what I'm about to say. So remember on the very first part of, what was it, chapter 6, we talked about when the carbon attached to the group as 1R group, it's primary. When the carbon is attached to 2R groups, it's secondary. And when the carbon that's attached to X, here being bromide, has 3R groups, it is tertiary. Why don't you give me your notes, and I'll tell you what page that is, so you can take a look at that. I think it's at the very beginning of chapter 6. Does anybody, you guys can probably find it faster than me. Where do we talk about primary, secondary, tertiary? That was back in 4, wasn't it?
That was with things that I believe are carbon. So
it's still the same thing.
Yeah.
I can't find it. It's taking too much time.
Can you think the question arose from the bottom of the second column? They both say primary, but you wrote the name.
Primary. Oh, I see what you're saying. This is primary. Thank you. Sorry about that. Yikes. I'm in Thanksgiving mode today, as you can see. All right, does that clear that up? Did you were going to ask the same thing? You both asked, yeah. Okay, anybody else have questions? Yes?
What's on page 73?
73, where we say primary, secondary? Page 73 for primary, secondary, tertiary, yes?
For the secondary carbon, or for the secondary thing, since they're both methyls, how do you know which one's supposed to be the beta?
It could be either one is a beta. Yeah. Yes, so that one doesn't have beta branching. This one doesn't have beta branching, right? It's a secondary. Yeah, it has alpha branching, that makes it secondary, right? You're not seeing it? You got it, okay. More questions. So, beta branching and going from methyl to primary to secondary to tertiary slows the reaction down dramatically. I certainly would call this negligible, and this is a very, very exceedingly slow. All right, so in the SN2 reaction, the rate of reaction slowed by bulky groups near the reaction center due to steric hindrance. So remember, we're attacking the inside of the umbrella. And when you bulk this area up, the nucleophile is going to have a hard time getting in there and attacking. It has to get close to be able to react. And if you have a bunch of things there, so this shows it pretty well. This would be our ethyl right here. So this one doesn't have any beta branching. This is our alpha. This is our beta. This nucleophile has to get in here. It has to get in here and do backside attack here. to be able to react. So there's our very crowded transition state. This one has no beta branching. This methyl, this is okay. And then the bromide ion leaves here. Now, what happens when we have three methyls? And very helpful to make a model for this so you can see what this actually looks like. This chloride ion is really difficult for this to get in. And what we're really going to say with this is that when you have a tertiary alkyl halide, there is no SN2. This really just can't get in here. Very crowded transition state. The chloride ion has a really difficult time getting in here to do backside attack, so very crowded here. And so we have a very high energy transition state. So crowding the transition state raises the activation energy and slows the reaction down. So here's our energy diagram comparing a primary and a tertiary. Just a really straightforward primary and tertiary with no branching. And I fixed this on my transparency, but there's a line here connecting here, so can you just scribble that out in yours? Or, unless I fixed it on yours too. Did I?
No.
So this energy of activation should start at the reactant and go to the transition state. So this one here starts right here. So we have, for tertiary, we have a much higher energy transition state here, very crowded. Remember, because there's a logarithmic relationship here between the rate and the energy of activation, a small difference in energy of activation really slows the rate down. This is a very large difference. So this is a huge energy of activation. And we're gonna call this no reaction. So huge energy of activation, prohibitively large. Reaction doesn't happen. So we're going to say no reaction for the no SN2 reaction with tertiary alkyl halides. Here, on the other hand, we have small energy of activation, small EA, low energy transition state. Therefore, a fast reaction. All right, so we talked about substrate. That would be the structure of the alkyl halide. Let's now talk about the effect of concentration and strength of the nucleophile. So the concentration and strength have a huge difference on the rate of the reaction. How do we determine nucleophile strength? We measure rate of substitution reactions. So in this case, we're going to take a look at, and this is on the next page, so we'll come back to this page. But go ahead and turn to the next page. We've chosen as our substrate a methyl iodide, so no steric hindrance, right? Very little. And we're going to vary the nucleophile. And keep everything else the same. And we're going to go ahead and write the solvent in here because as you're going to see coming up, that becomes really very, very important. So solvent is methanol. All right, so we're being very careful here. And so I don't want you memorizing these numbers. We're going to be looking for trends. Okay, so notice a couple of things here. When we do relative rate, we choose something to be one, and then we compare everything towards that. So notice that water and methanol have the slowest rate of all. And in this experiment, they've chosen that to be one, but that has a very, very small rate of reaction. So notice most of the nucleophiles are negatively charged. Okay, so the water and the methanol are not very negative, are not negatively charged, and they're not good nucleophiles. Ammonia, on the other hand, it's not negatively charged, but it's actually a decent strength nucleophile, right? Okay, so these guys are, water and methanol are about the same in their strength, and these are bad nucleophiles. Just because we have a relative rate of one, I don't want to get you to get the impression that these actually work, because they really don't. All right, so negatively charged, when you have a deprotonated nucleophile that's negatively charged, it's really good. Let's look at the halogens here. We've got fluoride 500, chloride 23,500, bromide. What's happening as we're going down a column in the periodic table? We're increasing the strength, right? There's iodide. Whoa, 25 million, okay? Let's see, we've got sulfur. Sulfur's right underneath oxygen. So here's our negatively charged oxygen nucleophiles here. Wow, look what happens to methanol when we deprotonate it. It goes from 1 to nearly 2 million. And so then we have oxygen, negatively charged. And look at sulfur. Sulfur, wow. Okay, I'm not even going to try to say what that number is. Hundreds, thousands, million, trillion? Billion. Billion, okay. All right, and sulfur, selenium's right underneath sulfur over here. Yeah, over here, you can look over there. And that's, so we're definitely, there's a very clear trend that as we're going down a column, the nucleophile strength is increasing dramatically, okay? And so phenoxide, of course, is just things like this. That would be phenoxide. This would be, if you see this, ARO minus, that means that you have a benzyl ring attached to oxygen, you might run across this, with some other substituent on the ring. So something else like an alkyl group or something else, you'll use this as a more generic thing, but that's what that's talking about. And of course, these guys on the bottom here, sulfur, selenium, these are the best nucleophiles. So they have the fastest rate of SN2 reaction. So going back to this page, nucleophilicity depends on a variety of factors, concentration of charge, solvent polarizability, and the nature of the substituents, and we will talk about all of these factors. Best nucleophiles have a high concentration of negative charge, are highly polarizable, not obvious from this chart, are less solvated, and are not too hindered, okay? So we're going to go back and talk about each of these factors here. But first, let's summarize our trends. Increasing negative charge, increasing nucleophilicity. So 3,163,000 to 1 by just simply deprotonating water, which we can certainly easily do. That's how much we increase the rate. Ammonia is actually good without being deprotonated, but if we did deprotonate it, not on the chart, but faster than ammonia. All right, another trend that we didn't notice, but we can look at, is nucleophilicity decreases to the right in the periodic table. This correlates with basicity. So if we had this compound here, which we don't have on our chart, deprotonated amine, RO minus, we're missing some lone pairs right here. So throw those on here, and fluoride ion. We have increasing nucleophilicity as we go to the left. That also correlates with base strength. Increasing base strength. And increasing electronegativity goes in the opposite direction. So this is kind of, you know, if you think about a strong base and a strong nucleophile, they have a lot of factors that are the same. So that's not a surprising trend. Increasing electrophilicity. So something that's really electron rich is going to be a good base. It's also going to be a good nucleophile. All right, so our explanation here, it's kind of like the explanation that we used for basicity. Fluoride ion is more electronegative. Electrons are held more tightly. Therefore, less available for reaction. It would rather hold on to its electrons than donate them. All right, we also noticed a very clear trend. Nucleophilicity increases as you go down a row in the periodic table. This does not correlate with basicity. Okay? So we have, what do we have here? Let's throw a couple of these numbers on here. We have 5 million. Phosphorus is right beneath nitrogen in the periodic table. Phenoxide, 630,000. Sulfur equivalent to phenoxide, 7943 zeros and six zeros. Selenium equivalent to phenoxide, 50 with nine zeros. And I'm not going to write in all the numbers for the halogens, but there was a very clear trend. Increasing nucleophile strength this way. Basicity goes the opposite direction. But remember, our trends got messed up with basicity and acidity going down a column also. So this is kind of going along with that. All right, so question. Why doesn't nucleophilicity always correlate with basicity? Basicity is a thermodynamic property measured by an equilibrium constant. And nucleophilicity is a kinetic phenomenon measured by comparing rates of reaction. So they are defined completely differently. So as we go down a row in the periodic table, two things happen. The atoms get larger and the charge becomes less concentrated. We saw a demo for that. The charge gets is less concentrated. Smaller atoms smaller anions are more tightly solvated than larger anions because their charge is more concentrated. So F minus is much more heavily solvated than I minus. So let's draw F minus here. Little F minus. And we'll do very large iodine. And it turns out that methanol is an important factor here, because we know that actually fluorodiene can form hydrogen bonds with methanol, right? We also have some ion-dipole interactions going on here, but the fluoride ion, because it's so electronegative, is going to form very tight solvent cage around it. Iodide, on the other hand, is going to, we're going to have ion-dipole interactions, which are weaker. So still the methanol is going to, we've got the partially positive charge hydrogen, we've got the partially negative charge oxygen, and the partially positive charge hydrogen is going to align itself here. But it's a much weaker interaction. And we'll just put one more over here. So II minus has relatively weak ion-dipole interaction. Fluoride ion, on the other hand, forms a strong hydrogen bond with methanol. So the shell, we call it a shell of solvent molecules. Impedes reactivity. And if we go back to this picture, you don't have to turn to this page, but I'll put it up for you so I can show you what I mean here. Okay, so let's imagine that this is fluoride ion here instead of chloride ion. So that fluorine is very, very heavily solvated. Those methanols are on their good around it. In order for the fluoride ion to come in and do backside attack, it has to shed the solvent molecules that are in the way of that. It can't attack when there's a methanol right here in between. It has to shed that solvent molecule, because we can't have anything in between this chlorine and this carbon. So it has a really we're making it into a fluoride ion, but in order for this to attack, it has to shed solvent molecules, and it's so strongly solvated, it has a really hard time doing that. Okay, so that's going to really, really slow down the reactivity. All right, so solvation weakens the nucleophile because it impedes its ability to attack an electrophile. The other thing that happens is polarizability increases. Larger elements have larger, more diffuse, and more polarizable electron clouds. These electron clouds allow for more effective orbital overlap in the SN2 transition state. So again, we're going to go back to that same picture. And if you're thinking to yourself, OK, if we change this to iodide now, the other extreme, how is that really large iodide going to be able to fit in there? Well, it turns out it's iodide, it's like a fluffy pillow. It can actually kind of contort its electron cloud to fit very nicely in there. All right, so that's going to make it have a much faster rate of reaction. We'll stop right there. I hope you guys have a great Thanksgiving.